how they would like. Hey, good morning, friends. Just the regular Zoom intro. The bottom of your screen, if you have your mouse highlighted, you will see a mute button. Please keep yourself muted if you are on the phone. Please use *6 to mute yourself. That way we don't have feedback as different people are speaking. Your start and stop video button is next to it. Then there's the participant button so you can see who's here. Name-wise, then there's the chat button. You'll want to open that up so you can see the bulletin that Julie and Craig are posting this morning. Then screen share button is irrelevant. And the rest, if you feel the need to use reactions, reactions are the far one, and then leave the meeting. It's on the edge. You can also, you'll see an arrow that says one of two on the right side of your screen. That will allow you to see more friends that are on the second page. Okay.
Here's calling.
Barbara? announcements, introductions, or birthdays this morning?
I have a couple of birthdays to announce. Devin's 22nd birthday is today. He couldn't be with us from Worcester, but and Barb Dennis, I believe, had a birthday on Friday. So happy birthday to Barb.
Thank you.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. I just about forgot my announcement. I'll show you what I look like this morning. Want to remind you that the Wilmington Yearly Meeting College Committee is supporting an effort to establish a food bank for students on the campus of Wilmington College. I think we've raised about $200 for that so far, and we'd like to see more come in. Nancy McCormick will be coordinating that effort. And you can make donations through Wilmington Yearly Meeting, either by sending in a check to the office or by making a donation with a notation for the campus food bank on the yearly meeting's website. So please consider a donation to that cause.
Okay, we're all gonna unmute ourselves. And Barbara is not going to play happy birthday, of course, for herself. So let's all unmute ourselves and we will sing happy birthday in a Zoom fashion. Okay.
We need a pitch.
I can't give a pitch, so who can give a pitch?
Penny Lou, you can.
Happy birthday to you.
Thank you very much.
There are any others?
I have an announcement. I came in from the office.
Okay.
I get to introduce my friends Sean and Katrina today. They are the program officers at the Africa Ministries office at Friends United Meeting. And they are here to talk to us today about the summer mission focus, which is on Turkana Friends Mission. So Sean is bringing the message and then they'll be around for questions afterward. And I think our children's message, if the sound works, and I think it's going to work, will be out from out at Quaker Knoll, and it'll be the Water Princess. I'm looking forward to all of that, and I'm especially looking forward to you folks getting to know Sean and Katrina a little bit.
If I can follow up to what Julie said, so FUM's summer mission focus is Turkana Friends Mission, and so Sean and Katrina are helping us kick that off today, our fundraiser for Wilmington Friends to help contribute to that. So through the end of the month, maybe a little bit longer, we're gonna be taking donations. And you can either do that by the old fashioned way of writing a check and putting Turkana Friends in the memo line, or Duane has set up an easy tithe, an actual donation line for Turkana Friends Mission. So you can do that. Our goal is $700. So we would love to be able to reach that goal and send that off to FUM for them to use for Turkana Friends Mission. And I am super excited that the McConaughey's are with us today. So looking forward to that. Thanks.
Okay, now if there are not any others, Stephen?
We are met in the presence of God, and we do not meet alone. With the angels in the highest heaven, we gather to worship the Lord. With Abraham and Sarah, we gather to worship the Lord. With the saints of every age, we gather to worship the Lord. We embark on our own journey of faith, God's holy name be praised. God makes of us a great people. God's holy name be praised. In the desert and in the den, in Barrio and Basilica, God's holy name be praised. We journey in the presence of God, and we do not journey alone.
To tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, 'tis pleasant to repeat. What seems each time I tell it more wonderfully sweet. I love to tell the story, for some have never heard the message of salvation from God's own holy word. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story for those who know it best. Seem hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. I lend the sound of glory. I sing the new song. 'Twill be the old story that I have loved so long. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old story of Jesus and his love. I love to hear the story of unseen things above, creation and God's glory, of Jesus and his love. How light o'ercomes the darkness, the vision of shalom. How God dwells deep within us, and truth will lead us home. I love to hear the story. It covers us in glory to joyful, wonderful story of God's eternal love.
Yes. Okay. Are you guys ready?
Yeah.
The Water Princess, based on childhood experience of Georgie Seidel. I am Princess Gigi. My kingdom, the African sky, so wide and so close, I can almost touch the sharp edges of the stars. I can tame the wild dogs with my song. I can make the tall grass sway when I dance. I can make the wind play hide and seek, but I cannot make the water come closer. I cannot make the water run clearer, no matter what I command.
Wait, what is that? No.
Which? That's the tall wavy grass. And it dances with her when she dances. It is early morning, still dark. My mother wakes me. Gigi, my princess, it is time to get up. We must collect the water. Water, come. Do not make me wake up before even the sun is out of bed, I demand. Come, please, I say. But the water won't listen. And I know we will have to walk so far to the well. I am too sleepy to put on my crown. I think of the pot that will rest on my braids instead. The thirst comes quick. Dry lips, dry throat. I squeeze my eyes shut. I see it clear. I dip my toes in it, cool. I scoop it up and bring it to my lips. Slowly, I open my eyes. Nothing. I kick the dust. I grab my empty pot and place it upon my head. My mother does the same, and our journey begins full of song. My mama adds her melody. Our steps are light. We twirl and laugh together. The miles give us room to dance. Halfway there, we stop for a moment at the giant karite tree, long enough to grab a handful of sweet shea nuts for energy. We can keep the dance going just a little longer. Maman, are we there yet? Finally, I hear the water running from the well, the giggles of my friends, the chatter of women. Some have traveled farther than I, only to return home when the sun has gone to bed. Maman holds our place while I play with friends. The dance continues. The water is flowing. Pots filling with the dusty earth-colored liquid. Gigi, come, Maman. My turn now. The dance home has slowed to careful steps. My thirst so heavy, like the full pot I carry. Our song is softer now. Our shoulders ache, our feet cramp. I see home at last. Mama boils enough water for drinking. We wait, we wash our clothes, we prepare food for cooking. My father comes quickly from the field to share in the drink and the meal. He scoops me up. My princess, you have returned with the water. Drink, Mama says. Finally, every sip fills me with energy. I want to make it last, but I can't. I gulp it down. Clothes and body clean, sing to the dog. I dance with the tall grass. I hide from the wind. Mama brings one last cup she has saved just for me. Drink, my princess. Sleep, my princess. Tomorrow, we journey again. Mama, I say as I close my eyes, why is the water so far? Why is the water not clean? Where is our water? Sleep, she says. Dream, she says. Someday, you will find a way, my princess. Someday. I am Princess Gigi. My kingdom, the African sky, the dusty earth, and someday, the flowing, cool, crystal clear water. Someday.
The scripture I'm reading is from Genesis, the 12th chapter, verses 1 through 8. The Lord has said to Abraham, leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. So Abram left, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. He took his wife Sarai, his nephew Lot, all the possessions they had accumulated, and the people they had acquired in Haran, and they set out for the land of Canaan, and they arrived there. Abram traveled through the land as far as the site of the great tree of Moriah, Shechem. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. The Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your offspring, I will give this land. So he built an altar there to the Lord who had appeared to him. From there, he went on toward the hills east of Bethel and pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. There he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord. Then Abram set out and continued toward the Negev.
Good morning, friends. Do we have praises and concerns this morning?
I have a niece in Oregon who sent me terrible pictures of the sky around her home, but she's not in the midst of the fires, at least not yet, but she's packed her bag in case she needs to leave. And so as I think and worry about her, I think about all the people on the West Coast who are so impacted by the terrible forest fires.
As we are settling in for our time of prayer, I'm always curious to know exactly who is on. And now that we have spread this across phone calls and a gathering at camp and a gathering at the meeting house and people who are only on Zoom, it's a little hard to guess. So if somebody, can somebody tell me how many people are out at camp?
How many of us are out here? There's 18 of us.
Okay.
Can Doug let us back in, please, on the computer?
Oh, were you
on Jesse
in?
Jesse Harper? Lost the computer, and we're just getting back on, so we're on the phone in the meantime, if Doug could let us back in.
Okay.
Yes, you should be coming in. I lost you right after the reading of the book.
So 18 folks out at camp, and how many connections do we have on Zoom?
Let's see, 30 connections altogether. So that includes camp and the two at the meeting house.
Okay, that's great. It's great to be gathered with all of you, as odd as this way of gathering is. Do we have any other praises or concerns to share?
Both a praise and a concern. I'm always grateful for the in-person social distance time I get to spend with my grandmothers, but just worried about them and all the other elderly as the pandemic continues, and we've been at this for 6 months.
I'll follow along with that. We buried my cousin, Betty West, a couple of days ago. I don't know if her son was able to get in to see her. We certainly weren't able to get in to see her for the very last 3 or 4 weeks of her life. Hopefully Larry had more success than we did. And so I've been thinking about the same thing Lucy's been thinking about. The idea of dying alone is really very scary and very touching. And so I had a brush with that this week.
Are there any others? If not, will you turn with me to God in prayer? Loving Creator, you are unswervingly faithful to us. You are the pillar of smoke that leads us by day and the pillar of fire that accompanies our journeys in the dark. You alone, living Christ, you are our salvation. And yet the temptation is always there to look for salvation in lesser things. You call us on a new journey toward a new land of promise, but our feet are slow and hesitant. We want to pack our familiar old idols along. Our old systems for prioritizing and making choices. But still you call us out of the old and into the new. Gracious God, forgive our fear and replace it with joy for the journey. Forgive our selfishness and renew our commitment to the common good. Forgive our passivity and teach us to walk mindfully. Forgive us our sins, living Christ, as we forgive one another. For you did not come among us to condemn us, but so that through you the world might be saved. Nurture within us that same generous seed. Lord, we pray for all of our political leaders, from the local to the federal levels. We hold in our hearts the work and the fellowship of friends around the world, as together we seek your kingdom of compassion and justice. We ask your blessings for medical staff and researchers fighting the COVID crisis, for teachers, students, and staff returning to school in difficult times. And Lord God, we are grateful. Grateful for the gift of worship, for those who love us well and call forth love within us, for the daily mercies and the grace that holds all things together. We offer our gifts of time and talent and treasure in response to your generosity. In all that we do, may the glory and the honor come back to you. We pray this in the name of Christ who leads us. Amen.
From Genesis, this time from chapter 22, verses 15 through 19. The angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time and said, I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies, and through your offspring, all nations on earth will be blessed because you have obeyed me. Then Abraham returned to his servants, and they set off together for Beersheba, and Abraham stayed in Beersheba.
Lucy, would you like to welcome Sean McConaughey for the message, please?
Sure. Sean is going to give our message today, and we are so glad you are with us, and welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Lucy, and the rest of you. It's really terrific to be able to be with you today. We are Sean and Katrina, and McConaughey is our last name, and we live in Kisumu, Kenya, although at the moment we are in Nairobi ahead of some appointments that we have here this next week. So we are not in our home, or we would show you around. But we're grateful to be able to serve with FUM here, and we have been in Kenya about 2.5 years, although the last 6 months have seemed like 2.5 years just by themselves. We are hoping to get to visit the U.S. here one of these days, but we aren't sure when that's going to happen quite yet. So we're glad to be here, and Katrina and I will be able to do a little question and answer during the Sunday school time. I hope you'll stick around, and we can talk more about Turkana there. And so, anyway, thank you for inviting us to be a part here. And, Zoom is kind of an interesting format, isn't it? We've been grateful for it because it allows us to visit our home meeting in Oregon. And I appreciated the prayers earlier for our Oregonian friends. We have close to 20 family members that live in the town of Newburgh, and some of them have their evacuation bags already, and several of the Friends churches back in that area have been impacted. We've had several small little towns almost leveled by some of the fires and those things. So it's been a pretty significant and scary time, and for folks who are living there. They say the air quality in the Portland area is the worst in the world right now. So it even beats out places in China. So you continue to pray for folks there. And there's so much, of course, going on this year, and so much that we're wrestling with everywhere. And so we understand how difficult that is for everybody. But you add on top of that the fires and some of those sorts of things, it sure makes it tricky. I wanted to draw our attention to this passage. I'm going to try to share my screen here. Let's see here. Let's try this. You can see this. Let's go. And I appreciated the Jenny Lou reading the passages from Genesis 12 and Genesis 22 today. And I'm not going to reread those, but I just wanted to put this one up here just as kind of a reminder to us as we think about this. It's in such a difficult year that we've had, it's hard sometimes to think about blessings. And yet I think it's important for us to think about those things, because in the midst of real difficulties, it's often blessings and focusing on the blessings that we've been given that help us take the next step and help us move forward. And certainly that's the case that we feel here in Kenya, and working with Kenyan friends here has been a real blessing to us, but it's not always easy. And so we're trying to focus on blessings as well. But this story of Abram, I guess, is a much bigger one than sometimes we think about it. And it starts here in the 12th chapter of Genesis, and really, in many ways, goes through all of the rest of Scripture. And so we see here that God calls Abram to go, to leave his country, to leave his family, and the place that he knows is familiar, and that he's going to show Abram where to go. But not only that, he's going to make Abram a great blessing, and a blessing to all kinds of people, and not just people that he knows or people that he's comfortable with, but people that come after him. And he talks about the blessing that Abram's descendants will be throughout history. And so we find that the first 11 chapters of Genesis are filled with a lot of curses, actually. We think about all of the difficult things that happened, the Garden of Eden, the Cain killing Abel, the flood, and on. And even after the flood story, people come right back in and continue in some of their the wrong ways that God has tried to take care of in other ways through the flood. And so we see this new calling on Abram's life to go and to be a blessing, because Abram has been blessed by God. And so Abram goes, and he's 75 years old at this point, and he departs and takes family with him, and his wife, and the people who work for him, and his herds and flocks, and he becomes a pastoralist here. He takes his herds all kinds of places away from what he knows to be familiar, and in an attempt to follow God's story and God's call on his life. You see that in Turkana, which is in northwest corner of Kenya. You see faithfulness happening there as well. In 1970, some American missionaries went, friends missionaries went. Missionaries had been in Kenya since 1902, but then in 1970, 68 years later, people felt called to go to this area in northwest Kenya and work with the Turkana people, who they are pastoralists also. They herd goats and sheep and camels and donkeys and cattle as their livelihood. And they used to be able to move all over the region. And as roads built up and as cities were formed, this became more and more difficult. And so missionaries went with the hopes of being able to be an encouragement and a blessing to the Turkana people, to bring the gospel to the Turkana people. And so they picked up what they knew from green and a place with plenty of rain in Kaimosi, Kenya, where the mission had started all those years ago, and they moved to this dry desert with few trees and lots of sand. And so we can get in our minds the picture of from chapter 22 in Genesis of all the grains of sand, because when you walk around in Turkana, your shoes fill with it. And so God promises Abram that he would have descendants that were as many as the sands, and that they would, again, be a blessing. He uses the picture of stars in the sky and sand on the earth. And later in Genesis, he uses pictures of seed, and he describes the seed of Abraham, which includes Jesus, and then includes those of us who follow Christ. So you see, there's some similarities between the Turkana people and Abram as he is going. And there are a couple of young men who join these missionaries, the Kendalls. And they are not Turkana. They are from a different part of Kenya, but they go and faithfully go to a strange place. when our first trip to Turkana from here, we took the head of the USFW president from Kenya, and she went with us. And she's Kenyan, and she is in her late 60s, and she thought she was on the moon. It was such a foreign place. It was such a place that she had never experienced before. She says, I've lived in Kenya all my life for decades, and I was in a completely different place. I had no idea it was like this. So you can, I knew from that. I just assumed that all Kenyans kind of knew what it was like there, but so many people have never been up to the northern part of Kenya, and it is a really foreign land for them. So these two young men who went with the Kendalls, and then later other missionaries, the Hummerk House family and others, became a part of the mission story in Turkana. And several churches sprang up in those days. And one of those young men stayed on as the director of the Turkana mission up until the early 2000s, actually. And so he was there and a part of what was happening there in Turkana. You see from chapter 12 here in Genesis on through the rest of Genesis especially, and maybe throughout the rest of the Old Testament or the rest of Scripture, you see this outworking of blessings and curses. You know, this first 11 chapters were, there were many curses, unfortunately, many bad things that happened. But because of Abraham and God's call and Abraham's faithfulness, these blessings, this promise of blessings is a part of the story of Israel, and even then our story as well as believers. And there are many stories throughout the rest of Genesis, especially about this kind of going back and forth between the blessings and then the disobedience that brings about curses, which probably are more like results of disobedience as much as anything. And a big change happened in Turkana in that 2002, around 2002, because a Turkana man became the director. And big transitions happened. And there were good things that happened in Turkana before that, but there were fits and starts with the mission in the Friends mission there. And it was difficult to get things started. And part of the reason it was difficult is because the people who were leading were not Turkana. And when a Turkana leader was put into place in John Moru, who's still there today, things exploded. There was all kinds of blessing that happened. And when John followed what God was calling him to do, all kinds of exciting things happened. We see similar kinds of things happening throughout the story of the Israelites, and they go back and forth, but they always have this hope of this blessing, of Abraham's blessing that moves them along, that keeps them moving forward. Let's see, I wanted to see if there is a... this is John here. I will introduce you to him through picture. I'm sure that there are some of you who have had the opportunity to meet John. He's been to the United States several times. He's led the mission for almost 20 years, and he's ready to retire now so that he and his wife can go be missionaries in southern Sudan. He has a real calling to that part of the world, and that God has laid that on his heart. So he's hoping to retire as a director, which we're sad about, but we're excited to see the mission, actually, the Turkana mission, send him on to the next thing in South Sudan. Obviously, these men lived thousands of years apart, but I can't help but think about John in comparison to Abram and the real desire to follow what God is calling him to do. And we love John. John is one of the reasons, one of the best things about being in Kenya. And we consider him a good friend. So I hope you'll get to meet him in person sometimes. I want to finish up with, to help us think about, what does this mean, this blessing mean for us? It's nice to think about Abram way back when, following God's call to go and leave his hometown and to go somewhere strange. We think about Turkana and the blessings that have happened there through people like John and others, but that's a long ways away. So what about us? How does this impact us in some way? And they're all good sermons have three come in threes, you know? So there's these three aspects of blessing that I'd like to introduce to us. Maybe it will be something that you are drawn to as well. The first one is that in the Old Testament, and really in through all of the New Testament, this idea of blessing moved from the more powerful to the less powerful. It was always the more influential that were blessing, giving a blessing to the less powerful. So when people gave blessings, so we have people like a father giving blessings to the family. We have stories of that in scripture about the birthright and giving that blessing. We have kings that give blessings to their subjects and to the people that they rule over. And we have priests that give blessings to the people who are followers of God. So you kind of see this idea that blessings moved in that kind of direction. Now Jesus comes along and sort of upends the status quo, and he says really the only status that matters is the status of love. And so instead of just having powerful people be people who offer blessings, Jesus models for us that it is the disenfranchised, even it is the marginalized who can offer the blessing, and that blessings to one another, and that blessings don't have to move in a downward trend. They move outward because of love. And so it's not that God had it wrong, but Jesus is helping fine tune what it is that God's blessing means for us as we are blessed to be a blessing. You might think about, it comes to mind, Quakers, you know, historically have often reached out to the underserved. You think about Quakers reaching out to prisoners, to schools, to the poor, just lots of examples of that. I'm from the Northwest, and our friends missionaries were in Bolivia and Peru. And our friends missionaries served the marginalized indigenous people there, the Quechua and the Aymara. Those were the people that were marginalized. And that was the people groups that our Quaker missionaries went to first. It's like the gospel going to Turkana or Samburu. Those are marginalized people groups. And just another example of how the blessing can flow that way. But what does it mean to bless those who, for us, who are racially marginalized? That's been a huge question in our country these days. How do we bless? How do we serve as a blessing to those who are racially marginalized? And how do we bless those who are blind to that racial inequity as well? That's a tough question. But I think that's what Jesus calls us to as we understand this idea of a blessing being about love. What will it mean to be a blessing to the winners and losers of the November election? What is that gonna look like for us to be a blessing in those ways? How do we see now our movement towards those who we don't agree with or that we see things differently from? just a couple of questions to keep in mind. Secondly, the blessing in the Old Testament especially was intended to bring prosperity and success. So the idea of the blessing a king might give, or a priest, or a father, was always to move forward the person who is receiving the blessing, that they might succeed, that they might have prosperity in some ways. Of course, along comes Jesus again, and he sort of upends this idea of what prosperity is all about, because he says the only prosperity that matters is being rich with love. And over again, we see Jesus saying this about this, what it means to love one another, and that is the marker. That is the marker for the what we are called to do and to be. 2 Corinthians 5 describes it as agents of reconciliation. Maybe that's what we need to think about being this November and leading up to November and after November, is agents of reconciliation, to undo the curses of Eden, if you will, which are broken relationships. You see in the garden after Adam and Eve have eaten from the tree that they're not supposed to eat from, all the relationships become broken. The relationship with themselves, they realize they are naked and they're ashamed. The relationship with God, they try to hide. Relationship with each other, remember, they try to blame one another. When God shows up and Adam says, well, you know, that woman you gave me, she made me eat the fruit. Of course, there is this tension between them. And of course, there is a broken relationship with creation as well, as the curses of Genesis 2 begin to show up in what God says, that we realize that there is that as well. But what does it mean to be agents of reconciliation of those curses, and to instead bring the blessing that God intends for us to bring because we have been blessed? We know that love often looks like sacrifice. We see that in the life of Jesus. We see that in Abram as he leaves everything that he knows. He even gives Lot the choice of which way he's going to go, and Lot picks the better land. The missionaries that went to Turkana, they were giving up something. They were sacrificing in order for the gospel. Of course, in Turkana, as was so wonderfully illustrated in that book, I had not heard of the water princess, and I'm going to own that one. We have water is life and prosperity in Turkana. Water is what keeps everything moving forward. And so we just see the need for this demonstration of love, and that's what blessing is about. And it's not just for the rich to give a blessing, but it's for all of us to be able to love. And the third one is that it's great for us to remember, and important for us to remember, that blessing, real blessing, originates from God. We're invoking God's blessing when we bless one another through our actions and through our words. We have to remember that blessing comes from and originates with God. Verse 4 of chapter 12 is probably one of the most important passages or parts of that story, because it simply says, and Abram obeyed. Abram went where God called him to. Sometimes our willingness to be obedient, our willingness to obey and do what God has called us to, is some of the most difficult thing that we can do. And yet, this obedience to God brings about blessing in Abram's life, and it's certainly not easy, right? We see Abram mess up all over the place. And that's true of all of the prophets and all of the patriarchs. We see all kinds of messing up. And yet this idea of blessing comes with, and in the midst of even disobedience, we see the hope for blessing and Israel being turned around time and time again, and individuals turning around time and time again to experience this blessing. You know, Romans chapter 4 reminds us that Abraham believed God. Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness, it says. What would that mean for us to believe God? Now, Abraham didn't always do that. He didn't always trust God, but he was enough of an example that he shows up in the New Testament as an example of what we are called to. John Moru always understands that God is the source of everything that the Turkana need. God is the source of the water. God is the source, obviously, of the gospel. God is the source of everything that is needed. And he serves in humility and with sacrifice all the time. He demonstrates that kind of love. John is certainly a blessing to the folks in Turkana. So what does it look like for us to bear God's blessing, to remember that the origins of the blessing are God? Well, it probably means that we offer obedience to God over all the other voices that clamor for our attention. And sometimes it's hard to sort through those and sift through what's happening, because there's loud voices that that want our attention and threaten to get in the way of our obedience. How do we bring life and blessing in our online presence during this time? I'm threatened. I'm always wanting to post things on Facebook to somehow prove that I'm right and the way I think is right and that my candidate is right. And I can't believe this person does this or that. I'm not sure that's a blessing to people. How do we remember that God has blessed each of us? That's the story of Abram. He was blessed in order to be a blessing then to others. How do we speak truth? How do we speak God's truth? This was and is, I hope, still a real important part of who Quakers are, is to be people who speak truth. So how are we doing that in ways that are a blessing to those people that we encounter, whether they be in Turkana or right next door to us or on our social media screen? How is it that we are a blessing to those, knowing that we have been blessed by God? Let me pray for us as I close, and maybe those thoughts will be helpful to you as you move on from here today. Father, we are grateful for your love. We're grateful that you have blessed us. Sometimes we lose sight of that blessing. Sometimes we forget that you are the very source of life. You are the very source of our life, and we are called by you as followers of you to be a blessing to one another. Not some kind of Hallmark card blessing, but a blessing that really is demonstrates love and sacrifice, that demonstrates faithfulness and demonstrates truth. So Father, help us to be those things. Help empower us to know how to be obedient, and when your voice is speaking to us. And thank you, Father, for this group of people that seeks to follow you. And we pray that as they do that, you would speak to each one about what it is that you're calling them to and what it is that you have in store for them. We thank you, Father, in your name. Amen.
Thank you, Sean, for bringing a new awareness of the word blessing. Lately, I've been hearing people use it all the time, and sometimes I'm thinking they're not really sincere when they are using it. Maybe they are. Maybe their feeling is from a depth. So I will put more emphasis on it, maybe when hearing it from now on, or maybe I will feel a little freer to use it myself.
Julie has invited everyone to sing together on this closing hymn, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah. Do please be sure you're on mute, and I'll play a very short introduction. And I've lowered the key, so it's hopefully in a range that we can all sing this morning. Guide me, O Thou Great Jehovah. Thank you.
it's not going to be easy. All of your roadmaps are wrong. That was another country. Those lakes have dried up. And new groundwater is welling in places you won't expect. You'll begin the journey in fog, destination unknown, impossible. Don't be surprised by tears. This right here is holy ground. Take a deep breath and turn away from cynicism and despair. Listen to the voice from on high and deep within, the one that says, I'm calling you to a place which I will show you. And take the first small step into the surprising sun.